Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Hey, it's Dan. This is episode 88 of Fireside Chat, and this is a little bit of a different episode. This past week, Matt and I spent the week at WinSport at COP taking in the Calgary Flames 2015 Rookie Development Camp. This is a camp where the Flames bring the rookies in and they put them through their paces both on and off ice. They do everything from scrimmages and on-ice practices to nutritional training, fitness testing, all sorts of things. We were lucky enough to spend the whole week there with the Flames, and we also got the chance to talk to some of the rookies. So you'll hear in this episode, Matt and I recording live from WinSport each day, what we think of what we've seen on the ice, our thoughts, our comments, that sort of thing, and then also some rinkside interviews with the prospects just as they were getting off the ice each day. We hope you guys enjoy listening to this as much as we did making it. This is Dan and Matt, and we're here live at the 2015 Calgary Flames Developmental Rookie Camp. And day one has just ended, so we saw practices from all four groups. And we're just going to give you guys a quick rundown of some of our thoughts today. So, Matt, why don't we start with you? Overall thoughts from today?
It was an interesting performance from a lot of players. This camp hasn't been as deep as previous years.
Well, we're also missing four top rookies because we gave away a lot of picks this year.
True. And because of that, it's a little thinner. There's a lot more walk-on players this year. But the overall talent level isn't severely lessened by that.
I think it's interesting if you take a look at the way they've arranged the groups. So for those that aren't here, Group A and B practice together, and then Group C and D practice together. If you take a look at Group A, we've got like Anderson, Carroll, Jankowski, Kanzig, Klimchuk, Olas Mattsson. Group B, we've got, you know, Bennett, Hickey, Mangiapane, Poirier, and then Group C and D is pretty much all walk-on players with a couple veterans. So it's kind of interesting that I would think that they would want to spread that out a little bit more.
True, but it's better to evaluate the walk-on players, having them all grouped together, so especially when it comes to the scrimmage where you have legitimate drafted NHL players to compete against those guys to see if any of them are worth actually offering a contract to.
So let's talk about the morning practice first. So this year, one of the things that they're doing, I guess, when Treliving came in last year, he had said that he wanted to have less scrimmages and he wanted to have more practice sessions so that they could evaluate talent a bit better. This morning we saw Group A and B. What were your thoughts of the A-B groups?
Lots of talent in each group. I think that of all the players, the best one overall was Mark Jankowski. I think he showed a lot of good skill. His foot speed was top-notch, good hands, and just overall dynamic play from him.
I wasn't really sure what to expect from him this year. We didn't see him last year. We know that when the Flames picked him, it was a little bit of a flyer pick, if you will. There's a lot of people that weren't too happy about it. But he was actually on a line today, with Sam Bennett and Morgan Klimchuk. And I thought the three of them looked really good this morning, working well together. They seemed to have good chemistry. Their passes were on the tape. So I really like the look of those three together.
Yeah, exactly. And Morgan Klimchuk, he was sniping corners left and right, it seemed, all day. The goalies had no chance on any of his shots.
Yeah, and you know, you were mentioning earlier number 77, Mark Jankowski, and I was expecting him to be perhaps a step below some of these guys, you know, coming out of a college program, but we're seeing so many college guys here, and I was surprised the way that he kept up. If you didn't know this player, you probably would have thought that he was one of the guys that already turned pro or was just turning pro. Like, it's only day one, but I think, to me, he was the guy that shone the most.
Yeah. I expect Jankowski to be a legitimate top six forward in the NHL. He has enough of everything that one would need in terms of his overall package, between his height, his skating ability, his hands, his passing ability, everything. It's everything that you could ask for.
Some of the other guys that we saw this morning, we also saw some of the newest Flames. We saw Rasmus Anderson and Andrew Mangiapane. What were your thoughts on those two guys?
Rasmus Anderson, he was, you could tell he was in his first rookie camp, and he was probably he was one of the least fit players in the NHL combine that they had in the beginning of June. So he looked a little behind at times from everybody else, but that's to be expected. Like, even guys like Kanzig, who was a fitness buff when he first came here, he looked rather slow and out of place. And Anderson, he just wasn't overly noticeable. He was just okay. And for a first camp, that's what you'd like.
And we'll see if he develops over the week. I would imagine that they're going back to the dressing room and the coaching staff probably talking to him and trying to, you know, see more from him. This is their top pick this year, so they are probably expecting a little bit more out of him. Another guy we saw who was supposed to be in the morning group but was in the afternoon group, so let's transition to our afternoon, was Emile Poirier, who just turned pro this past year. I don't know about you, but I thought Poirier was looking pretty good out there.
Yeah, his speed is top-notch like it always has been. One thing that I did have a little bit of concern in his game is that his shots were consistently missing, which that might just be July rust.
Could be July rust. Could be that he was more about going hard and getting a hard shot than an accurate shot.
Yeah, exactly. And the drills that they were doing, they were all speed and tempo, not finesse and precision.
In the afternoon group, the CD group, we also got to see two of the most anticipated Flames defensemen coming into the system, of Oliver Shillington and Kenny Morrison. I don't know about you, Matt, but I saw them out there a couple times together on some of the drills when there's like a 3-on-2 or a 2-on-1, and I thought that they were, for guys that have probably never been on the ice together, they had some pretty good chemistry today for day one.
Yeah, and both of them showed a lot of skill, and Kenny Morrison looked the most NHL-ready of any of the defensemen.
Yeah, he sure did.
And their skill and ability was quite apparent. The one thing with Shillington, my mistake, looks a little weird seeing K-Y being pronounced S-H. One of the problems he has is that his backward skating is just a little sloppy at times, which that's just a matter of coaching and teaching, which that'll come in the years to come.
Another guy we saw this afternoon, who we didn't really like what we saw from last year, was Mason McDonald, our number 72, the goaltender. And I know last year you and I both kind of thought, we're not sure about this guy. He didn't seem like he was perhaps the best goalie in camp last year. But this year, both he and Gillies looked pretty good. Any comments you have about Mason McDonald?
No, he just looks a lot more solid than last year, more composed. Like, all of his movements are with precision, and there's no wasted energy. He gets to where he needs to be. Well, his glove hand was the knock on him last year, and he was making tons of glove saves, so that doesn't seem to be a problem now.
Going back to Kenny Morrison briefly, it was interesting after the practice today to see how many of the fans were standing there wanting autographs and photos. So this guy coming in as a UFA college signing already has quite a bit of following in town, which I thought was quite interesting.
Yeah, it's nice to see, especially when he had the choice to pick anywhere in the NHL, to come here and already have people wanting his autograph.
And you'll be hearing from Kenny Morrison later in the show. We have an interview that we'll be playing. Matt, the other story, I guess, today, especially in Group CD, was walk-ons. What walk-ons were you particularly impressed by?
Tyson Bailey, who wears number 47, and Brandon Hawkins, number 94, both showed quite a bit of offensive creativity, and they were both very quick forwards.
I particularly like number 75, Josh Pitt. He's a centerman, and he seemed like he was in all the plays. When they were doing their checking drill, there was a lot of guys that were sort of doing mediocre checks, but he was quite solid. He was finishing all the checks. He was doing all the right things at practice today, and we'll see how that goes all week.
with those three players, they all have been amongst the best walk-on players that the Flames have ever had.
And it's interesting, too, to see some of these guys like Jason Fram, who we saw last year as a walk-on, coming back. And I would have to imagine if you're a walk-on player coming back for the second year in a row without a contract, it's probably a good sign for you because this team probably is really interested in signing you.
Yeah, and he isn't the only second-time walk-on for the Flames. Chris Dines, I think that's how you pronounce his name, who wears number 93, he also was here last year.
And we're starting to see the Flames bringing in a lot more U.S. college players. We're seeing, as a whole organization, it seems like since the Jay Feaster era, we've really been moving towards the U.S. college players and giving them more of a look than we were before.
And that helps because they're able to develop more in the college ranks, like physically, because they don't play as many games. They're able to train more. So.
And they do have a lot more training time built in.
Speaking to the players doing the interviews and that, like Kenny Morrison was one of the most physically built players out of the whole group. So, you know, that is a factor.
So that was today's practices. Tomorrow we have, again, a set of practices. It's going to be skill development, as they call it, groups A and B and C and D as well. Matt, when you come tomorrow morning for the AB, who are you going to be really watching?
I would like to see a little bit more out of Keegan Kanzig and a little bit more out of probably Sam Bennett. I don't think he had his best game.
We start by talking
today.
To Flames prospect Morgan Klimchuk,
an interesting case
who we
today.
Asked about coming to camp and learning from guys who have already turned pro.
A guy who has, you know, as much NHL experience as he does, and who knows, maybe the coaching staff has told him to maybe not go as hard. They don't want to hurt him. They, you know, want him to be rested. We don't know what's going on there. But, yeah, I think that Bennett, it would be nice to see him become more of a presence. For me, I'd also like to see a little bit out of Adam Olis Mattsson. Didn't really notice him today. And a guy that you know I've been high on for over a year, Patrick Seeloff. Seeloff just seemed okay out there today.
Yeah, he has a good shot that's very accurate, but...
But other than that, he seemed to be missing key things.
He seems like a very average AHL player, and that's not going to cut it, especially with the added competition the Flames will be having with getting Shillington and Anderson and anybody else who they bring in.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Well, I think that probably wraps up our day one preview. Let's chat with some of the prospects that were at practice today, and then we'll be back to recap day two. Our first interview is with Morgan Klimchuk, and we started by asking him about coming to a camp where he was playing with guys who've already turned pro.
I think whenever you spend some time playing pro, no matter where you're playing, you're going to be learning. So I think every situation is going to help me get better.
And what do you think is the biggest thing you're going to have to work on between now and coming back to main camp in September?
Just getting bigger. I think skating with the pros here in the summer, trying to find ways, like I said, to be able to contribute, not just kind of hide in the shadows there and be a go-to guy, I think is going to be key for me. But definitely getting bigger, that's one of the biggest differences, honestly, between junior and pro is the size and the speed. So it's pretty cliche, but that honestly is what I'm going to be working on.
You were looking good out there today.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.
Have a fun camp.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks, guys. Nice to meet you.
So this is Dan and Matt here with Oliver Shillington. First off, welcome to Calgary.
Thank you, guys.
It has to be exciting to be here.
Yeah, it's exciting times right now.
As Calgary fans, we were quite excited when we heard your name called and saw that we've managed to get you in the in the second round. So that was pretty amazing. We're all happy to have you here. First day of your first camp as a Flame. What are your thoughts so far?
Fun. We had a fly session before this, and right now. On the ice, it felt a bit rusty. I've been on the ice for 2 months, so yeah, everything felt a bit rusty. The stick handling and the skating and stuff like that, but I thought it came back to me a bit at the end of the practice. But
you got a week to work on it.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it's good to get some ice during the summer and stuff like that. And it's not the funnest to get on the ice when you haven't been there for 2 months. So yeah, but it's getting there.
Looking at the Calgary roster and looking at the success of this young team last year, you have to be excited to be joining this organization.
Yeah, of course. It's been a young player. Many young players have been knocking on the door for the NHL team, and it's fun to be a part of the organization right now. And I think Calgary is very upcoming, and hopefully they can win a Stanley Cup.
Do you think that you need to work on in your game to make it to the next level?
Maybe I think I'm very comfortable in the offensive zone, but I think I need to work on some details in the own end, maybe play a bit smarter here and make smart decisions, easier passes from the back end there, and maybe get more physical sometimes, and get more weight.
How much do you think playing in Sweden has helped your game, playing at that level there?
I think it helped me a lot to play with men and
men and professionals.
Exactly, and play against older guys have helped me a lot and helped me develop more and make me better, harder in the gym and on the ice to catch up with them and stuff like that. So it helped me a lot.
Well, thanks for your time, Oliver, and we look forward to seeing you this week.
Thank you, guys.
So we're here with Ryan Culkin after day one of rookie camp. Ryan, you turned pro last year, and we saw more of an offensive side, I think, than we saw from you in junior. What adjustments did you make to your game last year of playing in the American League?
Well, you know, it was difficult for me. Obviously, I ended my junior career as one of the older players, and then coming into the American Hockey League, one of the younger players. Guys have families. There's 35-year-old men, but I competed every game. Wanted to be a difference maker, and I think I accomplished that in the some of the games that I played in the American Hockey League, and I'm going to use that to my advantage, and I will hopefully come back in September and fight for a spot.
We've seen the Flames really bulk up on defense in the offseason with some of the draft picks they made, with Hamilton coming in. You're a guy who I know wants to be a contender come September. What do you think about your game is going to make you stand out among some of those other guys, and what do you have to work on to really get the coaches to notice you come September?
First of all, I think this is my fourth development camp, so I've got tons of experience. I know there's some young guys that just got drafted and whatnot, but with experience comes like patience on the ice, knowing what to do with the puck. So I think the fourth development camp, I already know what I got to do to make the team, and I'm just going to do whatever I can come September. And obviously, that's what everyone's mindset is coming to the camp. You don't want to make the American Hockey League, you want to make the NHL.
Nobody's coming here to make the Stockton team.
Exactly. So we're all going to be ready to go, and it's going to be a fun camp, that's for sure.
How's your arm? Like, I know you suffered a season-ending injury.
That was really unfortunate for me. Yeah. It happened in February. Cut three tendons in my wrist, so it was painful at the time, but I worked really hard in the offseason with my therapist. The doctor helped me a lot too, so I feel 100%, and I'm ready to go. It's tough though, watching from the stands your team not be able to make the playoffs. So I'm obviously always going to be wearing these Kevlar socks from now on.
You got to do what you got to do, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it's great to see you here again. You're one of the older guys you mentioned at camp, and we've seen you progress over your three previous camps. So I'm looking forward to seeing the progress you'll make this year, and good luck making the big roster.
Thank you very much. Nice meeting you guys.
Have a good one.
So we're here on day one of training camp with John Gilmore. John, you've been around the Flames organization for a while now. With the team having such success last year, have you seen any difference in the vibe in the room or the vibe with the guys being here?
It's usually the same kind of vibe. Like, really good. They take really good care of us here, and we got a whole week planned out for us. And,
nice. You guys are going to the Stampede this week, I heard?
Yeah, we're going tonight, so that'll be fun. In the past years, it's always been a really neat experience to see the city of Calgary during this week.
For fans that aren't as familiar with you, not as many Calgary fans have seen you, how would you describe your game?
Well, I like to think of myself as a two-way defenseman, but also a lot of offensive upside. I like to chip in offensively, but also at the next level, I'm going to have to be just as good defensively as the next guy that's 6'2 or 6'3. I got to be able to play defense against big forwards at the next level.
As we've seen with some of the offseason acquisitions, the Calgary blue line is getting to be very interesting, so you have to be excited to be part of that, hopefully, in the next couple of years.
Yeah, it's just going to make it tougher, and I love it. Like, it's going to be, it means I got to work a lot harder, and it'll be tough, but it'll be fun.
So are you enjoying being in university with all the different courses and such?
Yeah, I love it. I'm studying finance, and I only got one more year left, so I'm going to embrace it and enjoy it for what it's worth.
Finance sounds like a good thing to be studying. You're going to be hopefully getting a big NHL contract, so knowing how to manage that money.
Yeah, who knows, but it's tough, but it's manageable.
Between now and September, when you come from main camp, what's the biggest part of your game you think you're going to have to work on?
My strength. I got to get my weight up, and I got to be strong because there's some big guys in the pros, and they're strong. And we did the fitness testing yesterday, and I got to get those numbers up because I want to be able to stand out to the coaching staff and management.
For sure. Well, thanks for your time. Enjoy your week here.
Thank you.
So we're here with Kenny Morrison. Kenny, welcome to Calgary, first off.
Yeah, thank you.
First camp after being signed. And yeah. You can see by the reception here already that the fans are quite excited to have you as part of the organization.
Yeah, it's always good to feel welcome, so it's really good to be here.
As you've seen over the last year, the Flames are, you know, getting younger, a lot of young guys getting opportunities. That had to be probably exciting for you, and I would imagine one of the reasons you chose to sign with the Flames.
Yeah, they give the young guys a lot of opportunity here, and it's kind of hard to say no to that. So they got a good organization and a great hockey city.
Since you've turned pro, what have you found to be some of the biggest things in your game that you think you're going to have to work on before coming to the main camp in September?
I feel like at the off ice, just being here and living as a professional, like day to day, even in the summertime, just doing the right thing away from the rink is a big thing, and it helps out in the long run.
Are you glad that you're finally out of university and no more tests or exams or anything like that?
I still have a year left of school, so I kind of plan on getting that out of the way, so I'm not done yet.
Doing that while you're playing?
I've got to figure that out. Hopefully some online
talk
classes.
To Johnny, he did that.
Yeah.
He can give you some help.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's one of the things the Flames have been doing a lot lately is they've been taking those, you know, college athletes and bringing them in and giving them those pro shots. And even just seeing you out there today, it looks like you're keeping up with the pro game very well. And
yeah.
How are you feeling after your first skate of the rookie camp?
Yeah, there's a lot of good players out here, a lot of good young talent. And it's just good to be out on the ice with the guys again and get the blood flowing and legs moving. It's a lot of fun.
It was great to see you.
Yeah, this is your first time being in Calgary, right?
I'm from Lloydminster, so I've been to Calgary lots of times for peewee tournaments and Phantom and all that.
So you're familiar with the city, which is always probably nice too, right?
Beautiful city.
We were going to ask you about Stampede, but
I've never been to Stampede.
You've never been to Stampede?
No.
I hear you guys are going tonight.
I think we are.
Well, enjoy it. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I hear. Good to see the rodeo.
Yeah, the rodeo is always fun.
Yeah.
Well, thanks a lot, Kenny. We look forward to seeing a lot more of you in the coming seasons.
This is Dan and Matt, and we're talking to Brandon Hickey.
You know, as a guy who's been here for 2 years now and a guy who's had a chance to play with some of the elite players in this draft, what do you think the biggest thing you've learned over the last year about kind of, you know, playing with that higher level player has been?
Well, you know, you always see those guys were like doing the extra work in the gym, and I think coming into college you don't really see that aspect in the junior as much, but then you see those guys like Eichel and Oxen, and those guys are always in the gym shooting pucks, they're always lifting extra weights. So I think you see those high-level elite players in college doing that sort of game or doing that sort of work, and I think that really rubs off on you.
And you get to train a lot more than most, you know, CHL players too, right?
Yeah, we lift heavy 3 times a week, and then get a day off, and you start the games on the Friday, Saturday. So it seems like it's a light schedule for games, but you're definitely lifting way more.
Well, so people always say you guys are only playing 40 games a year, but it sounds like you're in the gym or working out every day.
Yeah, in the gym, working out every day. You know, I think that really helps develop the strength side of the game. It helps put on that little bit more weight, a little bit more strength, and playing against really big guys too at the college level really helps that as well.
How have you adjusted to the student life and all the fun college courses and that?
You know, it's really good because at BU you're always treated like just a regular student. Like sometimes we do miss classes for games and stuff, but they don't give you any extra attention because you're a hockey player, and I think that really helps. You get start to create bonds with people who are just like regular students just there going to school, and it's really nice actually to get to branch out and get to know more people.
Yeah.
Have you been to the Stampede this year yet?
No, we're going tonight.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well, you have fun when you go.
Yeah.
And what do you think the biggest thing you have to work on between now and main camp in September is going to be?
I'd say I just need to put a little bit more size on, a little bit more strength, and I'd say continue to work on my defensive and offensive side of the game. You know, you can never be satisfied with your game. Always got to work on all aspects.
For sure. Well, thanks for your time, Brennan.
We're joined by one of the newest members of the Calgary Flames organization, Andrew Mongepin. Andrew, you're out on the ice for the first time at your first pro camp. How was it today?
It was a good first day here, and excited for tomorrow.
What is the biggest thing in your game that you think you're going to have to work on between now and main camp in September?
Probably, I guess, off ice more, right? Getting bigger and stronger kind of thing. So, I mean, me being smaller, I got to get stronger against these bigger guys.
Last year, you went undrafted. What do you think you changed in your game to flag the Flames' attention to select you?
Yeah, my first year, I kind of, I guess, came out of nowhere, right? So I was kind of a long shot to get drafted. So the people who, I guess, were trying to say, or people were thinking that, okay, it was just a fluke kind of thing, right? So I feel like I had to prove myself again this following year, and I did that, and, you know, I got picked up. So that's all.
Coming into an organization that, as we've seen over the last year especially, has been great at developing young players, there's got to be some excitement that you're picked up by the Flames.
Yeah, definitely, right? Like, this, they're giving a chance to Johnny Gaudreau right now. So, I mean, he's a smaller player, so I'm trying to, I guess, gives me kind of hope that I could play in the NHL.
And if you look at our roster, it's made up by a lot of draft picks who were taken in later rounds. You know, it's not all first-round, second-round guys. Even Gaudreau is a fourth-rounder. So there's got to be some, you know, some good things there that you can see as being a lower-round pick, that there's some good development happening.
Yeah, definitely. I guess they emphasize whether you're first or last or not even picked. You know, you all got a shot at making the team, they said.
That's excellent.
Yeah.
Enjoying your time in Calgary so far?
Yeah, definitely.
You're going to the Stampede tonight?
Yeah, excited for that.
Is this your first Stampede?
Yeah.
We'll enjoy it.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks for your time.
Our last interview for the first day of training camp is with Emile Poirier.
So we're here on day one of rookie camp. You have obviously had an interesting year. You turned pro. You got a look here in Calgary this year. What have you learned about your game in the last 12 months since this time last year?
I think I improved in a lot of areas of my game. I think I've become stronger in different part of the game, and that was the number one thing when I'm coming pro, and I think it's went well, and I think my game's just got stronger in every area of the game, so yeah, I'm happy about that.
And you've got to be pushing for a roster spot here in Calgary this year. What do you think you're going to have to work on between now and September to be able to get a look for one of the roster spots here?
I think just get here in shape, just getting here and try to play my game, just focus on what I've been doing since I play hockey, just work hard, and try to find a spot on the roster.
At the beginning of last season, you were injured. Are you having any troubles with that still? Or
No, that's all clear. It's all, we did, my therapist guy did an unbelievable job with that, so I'm all good now.
Seeing you playing a little bit in the NHL last year, we were quite impressed by what we were seeing coming off the injury, so I can only imagine some good things are going to be coming this year. We're excited to see what's going to happen with you, and good luck making the team.
Thanks a lot, eh?
Thanks a lot. Thanks for chatting with us.
And it's the end of day two here at the 2015 Rookie Development Camp. And it's Dan and Matt back with you to talk about what we saw today. So this was the second day of the practices. Tomorrow we'll see the scrimmage. But Matt, let's talk about some of our thoughts. What were your overall thoughts for today?
I thought that some of the players that struggled yesterday actually ended up playing a little bit better today. Poirier and Bennett specifically, they looked a little bit more into it and more energized.
Bennett was the guy that I was thinking about yesterday, as we talked about. Bennett didn't seem like he was really into it. He was maybe not putting in 100%, and today he was, I think, one of the more noticeable players in the morning group, because he was definitely playing to his speed and strength.
And another player that we didn't really get to see too much of because he was at the far end of the ice was John Gillies. And today he was over at the viewing side of the rink. So we got to get a better look at him, and he looked very solid and composed throughout the practice.
He did. And, you know, you and I were talking. It's kind of weird talking about Gillies. We're talking earlier today about how, really, if you look at it, the Flames have Ordeo, who's probably, I think, has to be an NHL goalie this year. The Flames have Gillies, who will be our AHL starter. And the Flames have McDonald, who's our junior guy. So, you know, and we'll talk about this later in the show near the end with Craig Conroy about organizational depth. But really, I think that if you look at the roster, I mean, we have four goalies and two of them are walk-ons. So maybe that's an area that we're going to want to get deeper in.
Yeah, especially when you graduate players not only to the NHL but also to the AHL, that removes them from your depth chart. And organizationally, the Flames don't really have a ton of depth outside of the NHL and the AHL. Like even like amongst forwards, there's only a small handful of guys that aren't already in the AHL. So,
well, and with the goalies, if McDonald doesn't pan out, we're screwed.
Yeah, or if Gillies doesn't, or Ortio, like if we have struggles in net, then it'll take even longer to find somebody that is a Kiprusoff replacement.
But I think we deal from a position of strength there if we do want to
upgrade our prospect goalies. We do have, as we know, pieces both on in net and otherwise that the Flames could be moving.
Exactly. Like, if you look at when the Toronto Maple Leafs acquired Jonathan Bernier, who was one of the top prospects in the NHL, they sent Matt Fratton in a second-round pick. And the Flames, they not only do they have a lot of assets in terms of draft picks, but they also have a lot of NHL-ready forwards and defensemen that they could move in a deal if none of the goaltenders are panning out in the next couple of seasons.
For sure. Jumping back to practice today, another guy that, I don't know about you, but in the morning group, I thought that Andrew Mangiapane was more noticeable today than he was yesterday. He seemed like he was shooting harder. He seemed like he was working a bit harder. I noticed him. Every time I was looking at the ice, I was noticing him today.
Yeah, he looked more assertive. Like yesterday, he was getting pushed off the puck somewhat easily at times and was having ups and downs. Like, he did have some flashes of skill, and you could see why the Flames drafted him, but you could also tell it was his first development camp. So this time today, like, he was looking a little bit more knowing what he was expected to do and following through on that.
For sure. Any other thoughts on the morning group?
Not really. They all were more or less playing like all the other players, like Jankowski, Klimchuk, the other guys, like, they all seemed to play at the level that they did yesterday. More or less. Like, there wasn't anybody that looked drastically worse or anything.
No, that's it. Nobody went down today.
No.
I think we saw a couple guys maybe elevate their game, but otherwise everyone just kind of stayed at about where they were yesterday. And as you and I have talked about too, it's hard to really evaluate a player's talent for us during a practice when they're isolating specific skills. So it'll be interesting tomorrow during the scrimmage to see these guys in a game scenario.
Yeah, like, if you look at, like, how a player, like, if you're looking at exactly, like, how a player skates and, like, he transitions in skating backwards and that, the practices are very good to sort that out. But, like, to gauge how they will play in a game scenario, you need to be in a game scenario to see that, as you were saying.
Mm. And one of the interesting things they did today for both groups is yesterday everybody did the same drills on either side of the ice. Today, they kind of broke both groups up into smaller groups. We had a couple of groups of defensemen, a couple of groups of forwards, and they were all working on different things. So I think that after the first day, the coaching staff probably went away and said, these are what these guys need to work on, this is what this guy needs to work on. So I think we're starting to see some individual skill development coming out.
Yeah, well, one of the drills for the defensemen was for them to skate around the faceoff circle, skating backwards and laterally, into the front of the net and then back with the puck and, like, making sure that they were keeping control of that. Well, for a forward, that skill isn't something that they will ever need, because how often do you see a forward skating backwards? So, you know, that's why, like, having them tailor things specifically for each group made a lot of sense.
And the other thing I'm noticing with the defensemen is there's a lot of work we've seen both yesterday and today on point shots and, you know, having those defensemen in more of an offensive role. So you can tell that the organization is putting a lot of value into making the defensemen join the rush and that sort of thing. Even we're seeing drills where two forwards are coming in and defensemen's joining them halfway. So they're putting a lot more emphasis into the offensive side of that.
Yes. And, like, even a player that's not noted for his offensive game, Kagan Kanzig, he was doing a lot of excellent work today with transitioning and doing all the going through all the motions for the skating that, like, last year and the year before, it stood out as being a problem. And this year, if you didn't look at the number and, well, the fact that he's 6'7", you know, you wouldn't know that that was a problem for that player at any point.
Jumping into the afternoon groups, the group C and D, these are groups that have, as we mentioned yesterday, more tryout players, more players that are not signed to Flames contracts. And I think there's a couple names that we were saying were standing out. You were really interested in what Marcotte was doing today.
Yeah, he seemed to, well, he's not a walk-on player. The Flames.
No, he's not. Yeah, contract. But this is his first camp.
Yeah, he looked like he was really busting it out today. His foot speed is quite noticeable, and he does have an excellent wrist shot.
The other thing that was interesting is Kenny Morrison is in this group, and as we talked about yesterday, he's looking really good. We've seen him already play at the pro level in the AHL. We're seeing him look fantastic here. I'm really interested to see how Morrison and Shillington, who are in the CD group, are going to look tomorrow in the scrimmage in a game scenario against some of the big shooters like Bennett.
Yeah, exactly. And with how the groups are set up, A and B have a lot of the top-notch forwards like Jankowski, Klimchuk, Bennett, and so on, where group C and D tend to have more of the better defensemen. So it'll be interesting to see which side of that ends up winning out.
Another guy that I thought from the tryout group that looked good today, and we mentioned him briefly yesterday, was number 75, Josh Pitt. His numbers last year, you were looking him up, weren't great at the college level, but he looked like he had some pretty good foot speed today. We were seeing him do some quite tight turns. He was moving at quite a good clip. So I think maybe there's something to this guy.
Yeah, and he does have a good handle on things. His shot's a little weaker than some players, but it's not noticeably terrible. I don't even understand why he got so few points considering his apparent talent levels.
And who knows? I mean, you and I don't follow college hockey as much, so knowing where those issues might be, we're not quite sure.
Yeah, that team might just be deep, and he might just be a third-line guy because of that.
Could be they don't have a great development program. You never know.
Too much to speculate on without knowing more.
Well, Matt, anything else about today that you want to chat about?
I just am liking what I'm seeing out of a lot of players. Like, they're very composed, and like I've been to the last, this is my third development camp that I've been to, and the players all, like even the lesser name players, seem to be a lot more composed this time and more like NHL developed instead of like a widely disparate group where you had like guys like Gaudreau who were obviously awesome, and then like guys like Lyndon Penner who, you know, were not, they shouldn't have even been here. Like, all the players this go around seem to all be decent candidates for either contracts or possible future contracts or draft picks.
Well, I think that goes with the whole organizational change as far as drafting and that sort of thing. We seem to be drafting better, so our amateur scouts are probably picking out better amateur players to be coming to these camps as well.
Exactly. And like the only one or two of the walk-on guys have struggled mightily where you could tell that they're walk-on guys. So that's a big difference from years past where most of the players that were walk-ons were obviously not quite as good.
Mm-hmm. Well, we've seen 2 days of practices now, and we'll be interested to see tomorrow in the game scenario with the scrimmage how some of these guys are doing. But before we end off day two, let's go and chat with some of the players that have been here. We'll talk to you guys tomorrow after day three.
So we're here with Rasmus Anderson, one of the newest Calgary Flames. First off, welcome to Calgary.
Thank you. Really excited to be here. Seems to be a great city and a great team. So yeah,
you went
really
to the Stampede excited. Last night. How was that?
Oh, it was. I've never been to a festival like that, so it was really fun, and a lot of people was there, and so it was really exciting.
Did you win any prizes on the Midway?
No, I didn't. No. I didn't gavel too much, so okay. No.
So for Flames fans that are excited to see you but don't know a lot about you yet, what can you tell us about your game? What kind of player is Rasmus Anderson?
I guess I'm a puck move defenseman who likes to join the rush, get my puck through the screen, and likes to shoot, like to play power play, play physical at times too. So yeah, probably offensive defenseman.
And that's what the Flames are looking for now. It seems like the coaching staff is trying to encourage all the defensemen to play a little more offensively.
Yeah, I hope so.
What do you think you need to do in order to take steps to get to the next level?
Obviously, I need to get in a little bit better shape here, and I need to be a little quicker on ice, off ice, and get my habits a little bit better in order. So yeah, for sure, that's the kind of things I'm working on right now.
Aside from the coaches that are here this week, have you reached out to any of the Flames defensemen like Gio, Brody? Have any of those guys reached out to you yet?
No, just Backlund.
Okay. And yeah, I guess that makes sense, kind of the you know, country connections. It seems like right now Sweden's producing some quite good defensemen. You know, we've seen you, we've seen Oliver come out of here from this team. Why do you think there's this influx of great Swedish defensemen right now?
Oh, I don't know. I guess the 96 and 97 years. So it's pretty good back home in Sweden. A lot of good defensemen. So and the three the other two we have here is really good defensemen. So I'm really excited to be here with them.
We're excited to see you play in September. What do you think the biggest thing about your game that you're gonna have to work on between now and the main camp is?
On my game, I guess I need to get a little quicker and more consistent to my game.
Well, thanks, Rasmus, and we're excited to see you here in Calgary very shortly. So we're here with Mark Jankowski. Mark, we talked to you last year, I believe, but you weren't on the ice last year. So it's been kind of a year since you've been on the ice at a development camp like this. With the Flames having such success last year on the backs of their young players, there's got to be some excitement on the part of most of the rookies here at camp.
Absolutely, you know, there's a jump in every single one of these guys. You know, we were all, every single one of us is following Calgary this year and how they did, and we realized how special this year was and how only good things are to come in the future. So everyone's happy to be a part of this organization. Great organization, great city, so we're all happy to be a part of it.
At the beginning of last season, you were coming back from an injury, and then you started to take off about the halfway part. What do you think changed in your game to elevate your game?
Well, I think just my hard work ethic. You know, at the start of the year, you know, all you're trying to do is get a little better every day, just trying to develop and progress. And I think I did that well, and I think that's why I was progressing and developing and getting better as the season went on, which is what you want to see. And I think I was playing my best hockey at the end there, which I think is really important. And
what was it like to win the championship?
It's unbelievable. There's really no words to describe the feeling. You know, when final buzzer goes and you're throwing your gloves and sticks in the air, and you're just hugging every single teammate you see. It's an unbelievable feeling. You can't put it in words.
I think a lot of fans don't appreciate the actual work effort that has to go into playing college hockey. Say, oh, it's only 40 games, but you guys are in the gym and doing off ice how many days a week?
Yeah, we're in the gym Monday, Wednesday, doing hard lifts, and then it's every day. You know, we're practicing hard for 1 to 2 hours every single day, right, leading right up to the games, and it's a lot of hard work in college, balancing that with school and everything. It's a lot of discipline that goes into it as well.
And you're still enjoying your schooling?
Absolutely, yeah. You know, I'm 1 year left, senior year. Got a few classes to get for my degree, and I'll be really.
And what are you majoring in?
Management.
Nice. That'll probably help you in this career.
Yeah, absolutely.
So coming out of this camp and looking towards the main camp in September, what's the biggest thing about your game that you think you're going to have to work on before you come back?
I can't go to main camp. College guys don't go to main camp in September.
So. That's right. So even, you know, coming out of this, I guess, before the college season starts, what do you think you're going to be working on to elevate your game to the next level?
Well, I think one thing always is just trying to get bigger and stronger. You know, in the summer, in the off season, you're always, you know, lifting weights. We're working hard in the gym. So one thing, definitely get stronger going into the next year. You're always trying to improve that, obviously. And just, my skating, my offensive, defensive, you know, in the summer, it's time to work on, you know, your overall game. I'm just trying to do it as much as I can, work as hard as I can this summer to show a big chance next year.
We're hearing the bigger and stronger from a lot of guys. It seems to be kind of the new Flames, you know, mentalities. Everyone needs to be bigger and stronger, and as Berkey would say, more truculent, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's a huge thing in this organization.
It is. Well, enjoy your senior year, and we hope to see you pro in a year or two.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Mark.
Have a good one.
So we're here on day two of rookie camp with Keegan Kanzig. How you doing?
Good. How about yourself?
Pretty good. So we noticed your game pick up quite a bit this year, it seemed, when you came to Calgary. Mm-hmm. What do you think changed there that maybe elevated your game to another level?
It's hard to say. It was, you know, a big change for me. Totally new environment, but I think it was really good for me. And, it was more of a challenge part of it, being that in a new team, new teammates, you have to maybe a feeling of having to prove yourself more. And I think most of it was just being excited to be in a new place and to be in Calgary, such a hockey town. And, great teammates and coaching staff, too, who helped help me develop my game and become a more confident player.
For the Hitmen are quite a legacy team. You know, they've got a big legacy in the WHL, and I imagine too, playing near the NHL team, there might have been a little bit more pressure with the scouts and the GM and stuff being in that arena.
With when you know that there's the scouts and management and players from the Flames. In the arena, watching you all the time, it does have a little more motivation.
I bet.
I try not to think about it too much, but at the same time, I try to use it as motivation and and not let it hinder any of my performance.
What do you think about your own game, how much you've developed over the past year? Like, what are the things that you've most improved?
Going forward every year, I get a little more confident, which helps a lot. I think that's a big thing. And my mobility is consistently getting better, I believe. And just seeing the ice and thinking the game, I think the game slowed down for me as years go on. And I think that helps a lot for performance.
And being one of the kind of elder statesmen at these camps, you must be seeing a very different change in the way the Flames have been over the past couple of years with the new management stuff coming in. And is there some excitement there with the chances that young guys have been getting in this organization for all you guys?
Of course, yeah. I think that's, with Bob and Brad Treliving, it's, they are, like you said, young guys are getting lots of opportunity. And Bob said at the start of camp this year that they look for, the guys that are working hard. And it doesn't matter how old you are, if you're old or young, if you're performing well enough, you'll get a spot. So that's really exciting for young guys to hear. Going back to confidence again, it helps a little more going into camp.
Yeah. What is the biggest thing you think you need to work on between now and when we see you back for main camp in September?
If you've talked to me in the last few years, it's probably going to be a broken record, but I think foot mobility and puck handling are two big things that I consistently have to work on. As well as every part of your game, those are two things I will be focusing on, but just overall as a player, I'll be working to improve.
Well, thanks a lot. Did you enjoy the Stampede last night?
Yeah, it was good. It's always fun to go down and see the amount of people that are going out and enjoying the great weather and the rodeo down there.
Awesome. Well, thanks for talking to us again.
Thank you.
And good luck at the rest of camp.
Thank you very much.
It's day three of the Flames Rookie Development Camp, and once again we're here live from WinSport, and today it is July 9th, and we saw the scrimmage. So the only scrimmage that we're going to see in this camp, and Matt and I were both here. Matt, any overall impression of the scrimmage?
It was fast-paced, high-tempo action from both sides.
It was nice to see the guys in game action for once.
Yeah, it was 4-on-4 for the first half of each half, and then 3-on-3 for the second half of each half.
So instead of playing three periods, they played two 30-minute halves, and they didn't stop. And then we saw a bit of a shootout at the end of each half.
Yeah, half the rosters each time went.
So we had Team White versus Team Red. And Matt and I both kind of picked a team that we thought was going to win. And in the end, Matt, your team, Red, was up by one after the first. And your team ended up winning 8-7.
Yeah.
Not a traditional hockey score.
No. Mark Jankowski with the overtime winner.
So let's talk about who scored here for Team White. And we can post the rosters in the show notes for this episode so everyone can see who is where. But for Team White, Austin Carroll, Ryan Culkin, Matt DeBlow, Brandon Hawkins, who's one of the walk-on players, Pavel Karnikov, and Oliver Shillington all got a goal. Oh, and Philip Myers, another one of the walk-on players. For Team Red, Rasmus Anderson got a goal. Mark Jankowski got two. Andrew Mangiapane got one. Josh Pitt, one of the walk-ons who we've talked about previously, got two. Emile Poirier got one, and Hunter Smith got one. So lots of goals. And then in the shootouts, we won't go through everyone that shot, but pretty much we'll tell you who everybody shot if they're not a goalie. And we'll talk about the guys who scored. So for Team White, Carroll, Hawkins, Kanzig, Klimchuk, Shillington, Lomberg, Kenny Morrison, and Sam Studnicka all scored. And for Team Red, we had Riley Bruce, we had Carter Fogarth, we had Brandon Hickey, Hunter Smith, and Matt Wilkins, who scored. So Red won the first shootout 5-4, and White won the second shootout 4-0. So Matt, overall, looking at the two teams, they were pretty well balanced, don't you think?
Oh, yeah. Each side had a few good players. Each side had a few walk-ons. The coaching staff did a good job to make sure that each side had more or less equivalent talent.
And it was interesting because in the first period, we saw the two, Flames goalies face off, Mason McDonald versus
Gillies, John Gillies. And then the second half, we saw the two walk-on goalies face off. So I thought that was a good way of breaking them up, so no one team had, you know, a vastly better goalie than the other. Any thoughts on the walk-on goalies and what we saw from them?
They kind of let in a few goals that either Gillies or McDonald would have stopped. So it was only 3-2 after the first half, and then it was 8-7 final. So you can kind of tell that both the walk-on goalies had some struggles.
Yeah, Ryland Toth, who was the goaltender, the second goaltender for the white team, I thought didn't look very good today. I don't know if he was getting overwhelmed. Anytime there's kind of traffic in front of his net, he seemed like he was letting something in.
Yeah, and same thing with the other walk-on goalie, Adam Clark. He let in a couple of softer goals.
Yeah, I thought Clark was better composed overall, though. He seemed like he was a bit better composed. He was better watching the play, but it seemed like pretty much anything that was put on Toth went in.
Yeah, both the goalies struggled.
So hopefully that's not the only thing the coaching staff's going to evaluate these guys on. Some other notes that I was making here. One of the guys we've talked about this week, Tyson Bailey, who the Flames have seen in the past, I thought that he was looking pretty strong most shifts. As far as the walk-on guys go, I think he might have been one of maybe three who really stood out to me.
Yeah, he always seemed to have a nose for the net in the offensive zone. He didn't score, I don't believe, but he was always around the puck and setting plays up and all that kind of stuff.
And I think from a lot of the walk-on guys too, he was maybe one of the guys who showed some better hockey sense. He was making some good decisions. He was making some good plays. He seemed like he was anywhere that the team was, he was playing. You didn't see him just floating around the defensive end. He was a complete end-to-end player.
Yeah, and like on the offensive side, like he would peel off to, instead of like going behind the net, he would peel off and like loop around so he'd have the lane to pass either to the point or across.
Another walk-on guy that I thought was pretty good, scored two goals, and we've talked about him in the past. That was Josh Pitt for Team Red. We've talked about how we think he's looking strong. We've heard some talk around here of other people thinking that he looks strong. What did you think of Pitt's game today?
He wasn't as good in the first 2 days than he was today. Like, he seemed to be more of a bull in the china shop type guy today. Like, both of his goals were scored right in front of the net, banging the puck in.
And I talked to Ryan Huska, the AHL coach for the Flames, after the game today, and he said that Josh Pitt is one of the players that he really saw come into his own during the game. He says he wasn't maybe as noticeable during the practices, but he's really come into his own in the gameplay, and that Ryan thought that he was really good today. And as far as, I guess, other walk-on players who might have been doing well, the other guy that I really noticed in the second half was Sam Studnicka, number 55 for Team White. He seemed like in the second half he was battling very hard in the offensive zone. We saw a lot of sticks going towards other players, some checking, even a little bit of kind of pushing and shoving of the walk-ons. He seemed like he was the guy who was just working, maybe not working the hardest, but who was really battling it out.
Yeah, he seemed to be engaged physically. I don't know as if he has enough offensive upside to warrant a contract, but he definitely showed some energy. Might be someone to look at in the future, maybe in an AHL role or something along those lines.
And you and I were talking before we came on today, too. They also have to fill up an ECHL roster, so there might be some possible options there as well.
Exactly. Another player that of the walk-ons that I want to mention was Brandon Hawkins, number 94. He, in the second half, he just skated into the offensive zone from his own blue line and ripped one right past Adam Clark for, I think it was the tying goal. So just, he seems to have a really good shot. So.
Yeah, and we'll hear from him a bit later. Matt and I chatted with him today as well. So we will hear from him later in the show. Otherwise, why don't we move on to some of the Flames prospects?
Sounds like a plan.
I think I would say probably the guy who was the most offensively threatening in this game had to be Jankowski.
Yeah, he was all over the puck on both ends of the ice. he interrupted a breakaway. He scored a goal twice, including the overtime game winner, and was just all over the place. He was the most dominant player.
Yeah, I thought that he came out early. He was on the puck all the time. He had good positioning. He knew where he needed to be. We often saw Jankowski hanging out right in front of the net because he understood that's where he needed to be.
Yeah, and he also would muscle players off, which we haven't seen from much of that from him in the past. So he's engaging a little bit more using his size.
And talking about kind of offensive guys, another guy that I thought was looking quite good there was Emile Poirier. To me, I think he probably had the best all-around game today. We saw Poirier, you know, being an offensive threat and shooting the puck. We saw him setting up some really good shots. We saw him playing well on the defensive end. I think that he was the best all-around player on that ice.
Yeah, he absolutely undressed Mason McDonald with a nice deke move that caught him. You know, McDonald was just kind of floundering in the crease. But no, Poirier, he looked like a veteran player that was invited to the camp, not a green rookie.
And you could definitely tell in this game today, I think, the players who have AHL experience and the ones that didn't. To me, when I was watching, you could just tell the guys who played in the AHL had a little bit more polish. They were making a bit better reads. They were, you know, not always getting in front of the puck. They were just, I guess their game was just that much more polished than the other guys.
Although there were two exceptions to that, I think. Rasmus Anderson and Oliver Shillington. They both have really dynamic offensive instincts that, even though they're really raw as prospects, just being drafted last week, they both showed a lot of offensive potential.
Seeing even outside of the offense, I thought with Shillington, he had, I think, good hockey sense. We were seeing him make some really creative drop passes, and since he wasn't playing with guys who were picking up on some of those, so he'd make a really good pass, and it would end up on the other team's stick. So I personally, when I was watching him, I thought he was probably thinking the game out there better than most of the guys on the ice, both on the offensive and the defensive end.
Yeah, I think 58 teams will be regretting not, you know, 58 players that were picked ahead of him.
Pretty much 30 teams passed on him at least once.
Not a good idea. Like, his offensive skill is off the charts. And he scored a nice goal in front of the net as well, so, which was nice to see.
Another guy that really stood out to me was Hunter Smith. And Hunter Smith, we talked to him last year. Not a lot of Flames fans have seen him yet. But he was really using his... He's one of the bigger boys at camp. And to me, he was really using his body today. He was throwing people around. He was hitting hard. He was, I think, probably... Not so much from Kanzig, but I think from him, he was the biggest physical player on the ice.
Yes, and it's always good to see somebody that is primarily a physical player like Smith actually use what his skills are.
I think with Smith, he knows his game and he's fine understanding that game and just playing his way. I think you're seeing some of these players here at the camp who are coming in and they're trying to fit a different mold. They're trying to become somebody or say, I think this is what the Flames are looking for. And I think with Smith, he knows who he is. And it's like, hey, if this isn't going to work, then, you know, I'm not going to be successful.
Exactly. And it's always good to play within yourself and play to your strengths. You know, when you're 6'7", you're quick and you can hit like a truck, that'll tend to get you a job, if not with Calgary, somewhere.
Somewhere. Another guy that I wanted to mention briefly, I thought he did pretty well. He wasn't the biggest offensive threat, but just a good player on the offensive side of the puck, I think, all day was Andrew Mangiapane. We saw him, he got a goal. We saw him, I think, probably assist on a couple others. But every time he was out there on the offensive side, I tend to notice him for the right reasons.
Yeah, a lot of tenacity in his game. It was more of a positive performance today than the past couple. Like, he was even more noticeable today.
Yeah, well, and I think it's different comparing it to the past couple because the past couple have been drills-oriented, and really, these guys are paid to play the game of hockey. So what we're seeing today is really them playing a game, which is normally what they're going to be doing.
True.
So, Matt, any other thoughts on the scrimmage today?
Not much other than the Flames have a lot of talent in the organization. Like, you look at the names that weren't here, like Sam Bennett wasn't playing. then you got guys like Gaudreau and Monahan weren't here, so it shows like how much depth that the Flames have.
Yeah, so Sam Bennett, Garnet Hathaway, and Jakub Nakladal were not dressed today, probably because Bennett has a one-way deal. Nakladal's older than everybody. They didn't want to put him out. And I don't know about Hathaway. My guess is because he's just now got a one-way and they know what they've got in him.
But you never know. They might be just some minor injuries there or something.
Could be. But yeah, no, it's definitely a bright-looking future. I think more than this time last year, I think we can say that the defense has really been shored up for the future. I'm seeing a lot better in the defensive end. And I actually wouldn't want to be a walk-on defenseman this camp, because I think that there's a lot fewer jobs than people probably thought.
Yeah, especially when you have guys like Shillington, Anderson, Kulak, Culkin, Morrison. Like, I can keep going for a few minutes.
And even a guy who we liked last year, like Jason Fram, he's looked good this year, I thought, but I feel like maybe he's just getting lost in the mix.
Yeah, there's just not enough roster spots to hold 10, 12, 15 defensemen.
And other guys who just seem more polished because they've played at the AHL level or they've, you know, developed a little bit more. So, yeah, I think it's going to be a tough year for some of these walk-on defensemen.
Although the Flames do own their ECHL team, so there might be a possibility where one or two might get signed to a minor league contract and be put in Adirondack.
You never know. Well, this is the only scrimmage of camp, and tomorrow is the last day. It's Friday of the week, and that will be the last day of on-ice practice. So I would not be surprised if we see a very different type of practice tomorrow. I think we might see them working in breakout groups, kind of smaller groups, on issues that they might have saw in gameplay today.
Yeah, I could see that. Probably more focused on specific skill development rather than group development.
Yeah, and not just general kind of, let's all do this passing drill, let's all do this drill. I'm expecting more kind of focused, tailored drills tomorrow. Well, Matt, if there's nothing else, why don't we sign off and let's talk to a few players that you and I chatted with today.
Sounds like a plan.
So we're here after the day three scrimmage with Brandon Hawkins. And Brandon, first off, welcome to Calgary.
Thank you.
I heard you went to the Stampede earlier this week. Is that your first time at the Stampede?
Yeah.
How'd you enjoy it?
You know what? It was really fun. We had something like it in Detroit called Faster Horses, but I've never experienced anything like that.
Yeah, no, it's a great show.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Now I know what to look forward to if you get a contract with the Flames.
Oh, that'd be awfully nice.
So as one of the uncontracted guys from the NCAA, as we've seen over the past couple of years, the Flames have put a lot more stock, it seemed, into college players. Mm-hmm. They've been signing more free agent guys, that sort of thing. Looking at the guys here, what do you think you're going to have to do this week to really impress the Flames scouts?
You know what? I think it was kind of just getting to my game and playing the style that I play. I hope that's the reason that I was invited here.
And for fans that don't know a lot about you, how would you describe your game? What player would you say that you're modeled after?
I've always tried to model my game after Brett Hull.
He's a good guy to model the game after.
He was my favorite player growing up. But I kind of like to throw a little more physicality into it with like trying to be more of a power forward, get to the gritty areas. But in that sense, I'd say I'm more of a shooter.
You got 16 goals in Bowling Green last year. Mm-hmm. Quite a you know, good team there. Mm-hmm. Good player to be getting 16 goals. Would you classify yourself more of kind of a sniper? You're saying a shooter. Or would you say you're more of a playmaker?
More of a shooter, for sure.
More of a shooter.
And you know what? The 16 goals I had there, I played with two phenomenal line mates, being Ben Murphy and Mark Cooper.
Both great guys.
Yeah, and I mean, it's two trees in a bush. Those guys are both 6'3".
Yeah.
So it was awful. It was awfully nice playing with them because you put your stick out there, it's tape to tape no matter what.
I bet. That's got to be nice. Between now and when you start the season for Bowling Green, mm-hmm. what do you think the biggest things you're going to have to work on in your game are?
You know what? It's mostly fitness.
We're hearing that from a lot of guys here.
Yeah, I've come a long way since I was. When 3 years ago, I was 230 pounds. I've dropped about 35 right now. I'm trying to get down to 185 before the season starts. But other than that, it's, just trying to keep my style and don't let anybody get me off my
game. Exactly. That's all you can do, right? Yeah. Just play your game and hope that's what they want.
Exactly.
What has been the most exciting part of the development camp for you?
Being honest, I'm still like a little kid when I'm around like the first round draft picks and everything like that. Because, we went to a Minnesota Wild game last year and TJ Oshie walked up in front of us. I'm still like, I'm 5 years old. I want to get the guy's autograph.
Oh, yeah.
But it's a pretty cool experience. I just love that all the guys are together no matter what. We mesh well as a group. And you, no matter what, you look around, you always see a smile on everybody's face.
Great. Well, thanks a lot and good luck.
Oh, thank you.
So we're here after the big scrimmage today, and we're talking to one of the players who wasn't in the scrimmage, Garnet Hathaway. How you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. So this is not your first camp out. You're now, I'd say, probably one of the more senior guys, considering you're now one of the guys with a pro contract. Last year you had an AHL contract. This year you've got an entry-level contract, two-way. What did you have to improve in your game to go from being an AHL guy to getting the Flames notice and getting a full-time deal?
I think the first thing that happened, I got an AHL contract coming out of college, and that was really an opportunity for me. And Calgary put a lot of trust in, you know, a lot of respect for that to get that, and I think I earned that. And I had to work on a lot of things. The speed of the game from AHL, from college, it's huge, and, you know, it gets more physical and more skill, and I think I had to work on a lot of those things to earn that entry-level deal, I thought.
And, you know, you're one of the great examples for many of the NCAA trial guys here. Say, look, you came out of college, you got the AHL deal, and look at where you are now. So it's great to have someone like you, I imagine, for these guys to lean on.
I hope so, yeah. I hope I can be a role model and kind of someone to follow and use an example of.
Between now and main camp in September, what do you think the biggest things in your game that you need to improve on are?
I think conditioning's huge, especially coming into main camp. You've seen how tough it is, and that's what you have to be ready at. You have to work on all your skill and your skating, too, and it's something I'm going to focus on throughout the next month.
For those that aren't aware of, like, who you are as a player, who do you model yourself at?
I think I play a sort of different game. I've heard people can kind of compare me to Lance Boma, and I have so much respect for him, and that's a great honor to be compared to him, but I kind of take my own stride, too. I think my work ethic is a big part of my game, and I don't really shy away in the corners at all and in puck battles, and I really, you know, I'll put myself in the line to help the team.
And we saw some of that in Adirondack from you last year as well.
Thank you.
Lots of goals right in front of that.
Yeah, that's a good area for me. It worked out well.
So, you know, coming into, I guess, now being one of the guys who has an NHL deal, as we've seen with the Flames last year, there's a lot of opportunities for young players on this team. That has to be very encouraging for you, knowing that there's that opportunity to jump into this roster.
Yeah, definitely. But then on the other hand, you can't take anything for granted. And there's a lot of opportunities for guys to play this year, and I just hope I'm ready to – I know I will be. Not that I hope, but I hope I will be ready come main camp. And I think that's a big step. You have to be ready, and if someone does get injured or if you make the team out of camp, or you always have to be ready to be called up and step into a role.
And are you – one thing we noticed with the players called up this year is because the NHL team and the AHL team are trying to play such a similar game now, that transition for those players coming up was so much easier. Are you finding there's a lot of synergy throughout the whole system now for the Flames?
Yeah, definitely. And I think that's – you know, it's a great attribute to the AHL coaching staff. I think they really work well with the NHL coaching staff and everyone to prepare people. It's all about development, and I think those young guys who played games this year in the NHL – it's a great testament to how well the coaching staff did.
Yeah, it sounds like Ryan and Bob are chatting all the time.
Yeah,
so make
definitely.
Sure everybody's
yeah,
going
definitely.
Together. All right, well, thanks for your time.
No problem.
We're here after the day three scrimmage with Mason McDonald. Mason, it must have been different for you out there because we had the 4-on-4, the 3-on-3, not situations you're probably used to.
Yeah, exactly. They throw situations like that at you. You're not really prepared for it. You're used to 5-on-5 during the regular season, but now the pro hockey's adapting to the 4-on-4 and 3-on-3 overtime, so it's a good practice for that.
How did it feel to get out there and play in more of a game scenario than just the practices this week?
Yeah, it was great. I felt great in the practices. I came into the camp really confident. I knew I was better than last year. I felt stronger, and I think I had a great camp, and I just want to keep it going for the last day here.
You said that you were feeling better than last year. What do you feel that you've improved on your game since this time last year?
Well, I think control of my net. I think that I play a simpler game now, more in the crease like the NHL goalies do now. Before, I think I wandered out too much and kind of made the game more complicated than it needs to be, but I think I've really settled down and I'm finding my game a lot better now.
How are you finding the development camp this go-around? Like, is it more fun being through your second time? Or?
Yeah, definitely. I feel more experienced. I know what to expect. I know what everything's going to be like, so... it's a lot more easygoing and a lot more relaxed this year.
Coming into the main camp, what are the biggest things between now and September that you think that you're going to have to work on?
Just my quickness. This game's so fast now. The guys can pick the corners just like that. The passes across the ice are so quick, and I just have to work on setting my feet for every shot. And if I'm there for the shot, I think I'm going to stop it because my size, I'm so big, stopping the puck. When my feet are set, it's becoming easier and easier every day.
Based on who you were seeing out on the ice shooting against you, who should Flames fans be looking at as potential sharpshooters for the next generation?
Oh, God, there's a lot of good guys out there. Klimchuk looked pretty good today. Poirier, he dangled me there once.
Yeah, he did.
He's got some slick hands. He's a really good player.
So it sounds like we got some good guys coming through the system.
Oh, yeah, definitely. There's
excellent.
A lot of talent.
Being one of the few young goalies under contract here in Calgary, does it feel like there's going to be a lot of opportunities for you in the future? We've seen how the Flames are using you throughout their lineup now more than they have in the past.
Yeah, for sure. Well, this year I'm obviously going back to junior and playing in Charlottetown, and I just have to use that as a development year.
Exactly.
Help my team win as much as possible. I think we're going to have a good team there, but my goal for the year after is to move up to pro hockey. And after that, it's kind of wide open. If an opportunity presents itself to come out and play with the big club someday, I'm going to take that and definitely use it to my advantage.
So how have you enjoyed the Stampede experience this year?
Yeah, that was really fun. Watching the Chuck Wagon, the Chuck races, that's pretty cool. It's really mind-blowing how they do it. The horses turning around with the carriage on the back or whatever, and that was really awesome, going to the carnival and all that. And it's pretty neat.
And now you guys are going hiking this afternoon?
Yeah, that's going to be good. Did it last year.
Yeah. And you survived, obviously.
Yeah, the mountain just keeps going on forever, but you finally reach the top, and it's really relieving once you get there.
Well, we'll let you go on your hike. We've seen great strides in your game this past year, and we look forward to seeing some more continued development.
Yes, thank you.
And we've just wrapped up the Flames Rookie Development Camp for 2015, and we're here live from the Joan Snyder Arena at COP. I'm Dan, and as usual, I'm joined by Matt. How you doing, buddy?
Good. Entertaining hockey once again today.
So let's chat quickly about what we saw today, and then we'll chat about the camp overall. So today was another practice day, and not a scrimmage, but today, for me, it was a different sort of practice day. We were seeing a lot different drills than we had before. I don't know if they were drills that were based on the scrimmage yesterday, but we saw some interesting drills. The interesting thing that I noticed was every drill had an offensive and a defensive component to it.
Yes, they were. One of the drills was a 9-player breakout or 7-player breakout, and where the two defensemen were on either side and three forwards were in the middle, and they were breaking out into the offensive zone and operating as like a fully team offense.
And they were actually doing that right off the faceoff, which was interesting too, is they'd have a draw, pull the puck back, and then go on with the drill. So it was almost simulated game situation.
Yeah, it was a lot different feel than them focusing on, like, say, passing or stick handling in previous days. It was more game-oriented drills instead.
And I also noticed that the goalies were getting much better tests today than we'd seen in the past. In the past, as you know, if you've ever practiced yourself or been to a practice, often the shots aren't all that accurate. They're not really trying to score. But in those drills, they were really trying to emphasize these guys going hard on net and getting the puck past the goalie.
Yeah, and we saw both Jonathan Gillies and Mason McDonald moving quite a lot in their crease, and a lot of the drills were meant to make the goalies actually move or make a save and then try to save the rebound, which in the prior days they weren't really overly worked in the drills. It was more just straight on shots, no big deal, and today it was heavy focus on lateral movement and all that kind of
stuff.
Yeah,
to me, of all the practices today, we really got to see what the goalies had in the tank.
Mm-hmm.
We really got to see, you know, the goalies going hard and what they could do and what they you know, had to offer us. So for me, this was the best look we had of the goalies.
For sure. And both goalies stood out as performing well. Each of the goaltenders made quite a few excellent glove saves and robbing the shooters. So that was good to see. We haven't really been able to get much of a read other than the scrimmage game on how their performance has been. So it was good to see them where you could actually target focus on them specifically.
Some of the notes that I made today, for me, I was noticing Monjapan's wrist shot today. He was making a lot of wrist shots, and he seemed to be fairly accurate, and it was a nice hard wrist shot too. So I didn't know what to expect from this kid. I hadn't seen him a lot, but he looks like he's going to be quite a good shooter.
that's what you'd like to see from any of your draft picks is some flashes of skill. One of the reasons why Detroit always seems to find late round gems is that they have an organizational focus on players that have a really dynamite skill in some way or another. And like, it's one of those things where if the player can figure out the rest of their game to even a passable level, if they continue to possess that exceptional skill, they'll become an above average player. And like, that's how they got Zetterberg, Datsyuk, Nyquist, and like, I could keep going for like 10 minutes because it's Detroit.
And to me today, and we talked about his performance earlier, but I think Bennett really stood out to me today. He was going hard. He was the player I was noticing in all the offensive drills. He just seemed like he had everything clicking for him today. I don't know if he just needed a day off yesterday, but it seemed like he was really noticeable today.
Yeah, he was just kind of taking it more of a laissez-faire approach to it in the first couple days, but he really came out full force like you would expect him to play. This was like first day of training camp.
Yeah, for sure. And they actually had him practicing today on a line with Klimchuk and Carroll. And I thought watching the three of those guys together was quite interesting. I think they got some good chemistry going.
Yeah, for sure. And all of Austin Carroll, Morgan Klimchuk, and Sam Bennett have been playing above average this season.
So with this being the last day of camp, we spoke to Flames GM Brad Treliving this morning, and one of the things he was telling us is they were actually meeting with every player today, one-on-one in their sort of windowed office, if you know the Joan Snyder Arena, you know, it's the Shane Holmes room, and they were giving them all a plan for the summer. It's a plan for fitness. It's a plan for what they need to get better at, and he said they can take that and execute it, and hopefully it'll help them at whatever camp they're going to, whether it's the Flames or somebody else. But I really appreciate that attention to detail, sitting down one-on-one with these guys and really giving them a plan and letting them know what they need to do.
Yeah, it shows that they care not only about their own players, but even guys that may not, like, there was quite a few NCAA guys that were brought into this camp. And, like, last year, Casey Bailey was a player that came here, and he now is playing for the Leafs. And it's one of those things where if you're giving positive information to those players, even if they don't eventually sign with your team, they will have respect.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, if you're inviting these players, you can't really say, well, you guys are tryouts, you don't get this, but all our guys get this. I think you got to treat everybody pretty fairly across the board. I don't know what previous regimes did, but I think it's really nice that they're sitting down one-on-one and giving these guys that. And I would hope that come September at the main camp, they're going to sit with everybody again and say, how did you progress along this, you know, path we have? And I would imagine that's going to be a big indication of, you know, who's actually doing what they're told, who's able to, you know, improve where they're asked to. And that might be an indication of who makes the team.
Exactly.
So, Matt, any overall thoughts of camp as we're wrapping up today?
I was just impressed by the compete level of all the players this go around. Last year and the year prior, like, there was clear separations. Our guys were usually the top players, and there was not really much of anything else. But with this year, like, even the walk-on players like Bailey, Pitt, and a few others, they were noticeable themselves. And that was something that's different from years past. And, like, the entire compete level from everybody was higher.
I think maybe not having two scrimmages might have helped with that, too. You didn't really get a chance to kind of pit us versus them as much as we have in the past.
True.
I would agree with you. I think everyone had a good compete. You know, it's July, and as we've talked with a lot of the prospects, they've said that they're just not fully in shape yet. You know, you take a little bit off after the season, and you're just getting back into it. So it's all relative. If we were to come in September, we'd probably see a better level.
Yeah, exactly. Like Oliver Shillington, he was saying that on the first day when we talked to him, that was his first time on the ice in 2 months, which anybody, if you take 2 months off of anything that you're doing, you're going to be a little rusty on the first day or two.
Overall, I think for me, the guys that I expected to look good looked good. You know, you had your Bennett, you had your Shillington, Anderson, Morrison, Poirier. All the guys I think we're looking at to be standouts of this team going forward, kind of the next generation of Flames, to me all look like the next generation of NHL players.
Oh, for sure. And like you look at guys like Poirier and Bennett, you kind of expect them to find a way onto the opening day roster, even if there is not necessarily room for those two players. They look like they will force themselves on. And other players like Morgan Klimchuk, Oliver Shillington, Rasmus Anderson, Mark Jankowski, like they still will need some developmental time, but they're showing quite a lot of promise moving forward and a lot of upside going forward.
Was there anyone in this camp that maybe stole the show for you that looked like they were playing better, or you know, their skills looked better than what you're expecting?
I would have to go with Mark Jankowski, even though I kind of expected him to perform as well as he did.
Well, it's a first-round pick. There's a lot of expectations for
him. Yeah, I've watched him even before he was drafted. I watched a few videos on him back then, and like you could always tell the skill was there. It's just he was having a little bit of a hard time adjusting to his change in stature. So now he's getting a little bit more comfortable with his 6'3" frame, and now he's starting to use his body in pushing off players instead of playing more like a Johnny Gaudreau type player like he was a few years ago.
For me, I think the two guys that really surpassed expectation, one of them is Keegan Kanzig. He's had a great year. He's looked so much better since he came to the Hitmen. And I just thought from what we saw of him last year in this camp, he's grown a ton. And I'm really now more than ever excited to see him as he's transitioning out of, you know, the junior ranks over the next year and probably into pro. By this time next year, I think he'll be, you know, a full-time pro. So I'm really interested to see what we're going to see from him with another year junior.
Yeah, exactly. And before, like, I was kind of sort of writing him off as a prospect because of the fact that anybody that has poor foot speed, like there's only been three or four players that have had really poor foot speed that have actually stuck in the NHL, and that's because they had extremely high other abilities like Jason Allison, Dave Andrechuk, Hal Gill. Like Hal Gill, he was basically the Nick Lidstrom of slow people. And
it's an interesting way to put it.
You know, it's one of those things that the NHL is a very fast-paced game, and if you can't keep up, it doesn't really matter how good of a player you are, you're not going to be able to stick. So the fact that he's removed that hurdle out of his path, now it allows him to develop his other skills, and so he can work on, say, his passing and his breakouts and all that. So he can become an effective NHL defenseman.
Another guy that I was impressed by who exceeded my expectations was Andrew Mangiapane. You know, being a late-round pick, I really wasn't expecting a lot from him, but after seeing him at camp, I'm not saying he's going to be, you know, a top six forward, but after seeing him at camp today, I think we've got a solid player in Mangiapane as he develops.
Yeah, like if you look at the other player the Flames brought in, Luke Marcotte, he had similar stats in juniors to Mangiapane, but you could see that Marcotte's more of like a Brian Cameron type player that was just a very good junior player that might not be able to translate to the higher levels. But with Mangiapane, you are seeing some skills that they could translate. They might not necessarily work out, but there's something there at least. And for a sixth round pick, I would rather have somebody that has some skills than not.
Anyone that disappointed you? Anyone that you were expecting to see more from this week?
That's a real tough one. Honestly, I'm going to have to say no. There was nobody. Well, I guess in the scrimmage, I thought Morgan Klimchuk could have been a little bit more in your face during that. But realistically,
that's not really Klimchuk's style, though.
No, and that's why I'm like, I'm reaching for straws here, because there was nobody that overtly you're going, what went wrong with you, you know, and we have seen that a couple of times in the past couple of seasons where a player's fallen off the map a bit, sort of like Sven Berchi at times in previous camps, and there was nobody that just stood out as like, okay, what's going on with this guy?
I have one. I'm going to say a defenseman that I've liked for a while, and that's Patrick Seeloff. Seeloff was hurt last year. He didn't get a lot of play time in. We saw at last year's camp, he was getting a lot of time on the ice before camp started. They were really working with him. And with some of the defensive depth the Flames have brought in this year, I was really expecting Seeloff as one of the senior guys to really step it up and show that, you know, he's earned a place in the depth chart. And to me, I hardly noticed him in the scrimmage. I didn't really see anything that really impressed me all week.
Yeah, he's looking more like John Ramage, but with a better slap shot, which that's not going to cut it, unfortunately.
I think, you know, they'll probably give him another year at the AHL level and see how it goes, but that depth chart's going to get full in a couple years here, and he, I think, really needs to step up and make a name for himself if he's going to stick around.
Yeah, I agree. And it might be one of those situations where if, say, in 6-8 months, if he doesn't progress, then maybe you look at trading him like the Flames did with Max Reinhardt, because you will have guys like Rafikov and a whole bunch of other guys coming in, that John Gilmore, a few others, and there's not going to be any roster spots in Stockton. So it does become eventually a numbers game, and you, at some point you have to put up or shut up. And, you know, it is a business, and it sucks, but it is what it is.
From guys that we saw last year here to guys we're seeing this year, who would you say is the most improved?
Without a doubt, Keegan Kanzig. He, from going from my mind to being a player that was more or less a non-prospect project to somebody that you could actually see playing in the NHL, that is huge. And there are other players that have had a better camp. Like, Poirier was a little better this year. Jankowski was better. But I think for the most improved, it was by far Keegan Kanzig.
I'll agree with you on Kanzig, and I'm going to add into that as well, sort of a tie with Mason McDonald. You and I really didn't like what we saw out of McDonald last year. He was, it seemed, maybe intimidated or flustered for being here. This year, he seemed solid. He was, I think, at times during the scrimmage, the best goalie on the ice. He and Gillies are both fantastic goalies, but I really liked what we saw to him. It seemed like he's spent the whole year improving and working on areas of his game that he knew were sort of weak.
Yeah, and last year, I believe we were both commenting, like, it seemed like every shot that was aimed towards his glove seemed to be going in, and we were a little concerned about that, but, like, he was making even difficult glove saves look routine and easy.
Yeah, and they tested that glove quite a bit today.
Yeah, and, like, there was no soft goals that he allowed. Like, he was on point pretty much all through the camp.
So for me, I'd say Kanzig and McDonald tied there. I think we see leaps and bounds better from both guys. But yeah, nobody for me besides Seeloff. It was really disappointing.
Yeah, and even Seeloff, it's not like he regressed. He just stayed static.
He stayed static, but I think that he needed to up his game this year, too.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Especially with, you know, like Anderson, Shillington, Morrison, all these young defensemen coming in. I think he's going to quickly lose his place in the depth chart.
Yeah, and it's one of those things that because he has such a good slap shot, that you might eventually actually see him maybe tried out as a forward and have him try out as a third, fourth line defensive forward and see if that might be a fit.
Maybe. I don't know. We don't see a lot of guys changing their positions once they've hit pro.
Well, it does happen. Matt Pellick, the Flames' former first-round pick, actually played as a right winger for the Sharks. So it does happen. It's just odd.
So, Matt, before we break for camp, the two of us, any other kind of last comments on this?
I just want to thank WinSport for hosting this, and especially the Calgary Flames. It was a blast to cover this again this year, and I'm looking forward to training camp and getting the season underway.
Well, let's head to some of the prospects we talked to today after their practice, And we'll also wrap up the show after you hear from these prospects with an interview that we did with Assistant General Manager Craig Conroy, and that'll be how we'll wrap up this episode. Matt and I will be back in the next little bit, probably next week or so, and we will talk about what's happened since the draft with the Flames, some of the signings, some of the Flames that have moved elsewhere.
Any arbitration updates, anything, new signings, any trades, all that kind of stuff will be coming up next week.
So we will talk to you guys then.
So it's the last day of Flames camp, and we're here with Bailey. How you doing?
I'm good. Yourself?
Good. How was the hike yesterday?
It was a little more difficult than I thought. You know, I thought we were going on a nice, easy hike a shoal, and next thing you know, we're just sweating bullets. It was a lot of fun, though.
We heard you guys did a three-hour hike in 1 hour.
Yeah. We were kind of speed walking up the mountain.
And how was the Stampede this week?
It was a lot of fun. I've never been to the Stampede before, even though I don't live too far away from Calgary. I've never been there. It's kind of cool to see that.
Well, now you know what to look forward to if you come play in Calgary.
Yeah, definitely. The Stampede's one of the things on my list.
So we've been watching you this week. One of the unsigned players is here. And we've been quite impressed by what we've been seeing. Based on what you've learned this week working with the Flames staff and, you know, training with some of the prospects that are signed, what do you think the biggest takeaway is going to be for you as you go through the summer and work on, you know, getting ready for the season?
The work ethic and fitness, you know, that's one thing they emphasize is the fitness off the ice. So that's definitely one thing I want to improve on in the next 2 months.
For Flames fans that don't know a lot about you, how would you describe your game? Who might you compare yourself to?
Like a Mike Richards, a smaller offensive player that plays with a grit. I like to mix things up in the corner, and I have some skill and some finish.
And we've been seeing some of that from you this week.
Yeah.
The grit, the, you know, finish, those are the Brian Burke, you know, work ethic that we've been taught here in Calgary now, the truculence, as he calls it.
Yeah, definitely.
So, you know, being one of the guys who's not signed here, what do you think is going to be one of the key things you're going to have to continue doing in order to get a contract and move into the Flames organization?
Just working as hard as I can on and off the ice. You know, that's what they want. They want work ethic and character. So that's definitely what I'm going to focus on when I'm in Calgary in the camps.
And being a team that has, over the last 2 years, especially this past year especially, been really promoting the young guys through the organization, that has to be encouraging for you to know that there's a lot of spots for young guys here.
Yeah, definitely. I think they had 7 or 8 rookies this year. That's probably the most in the
NHL. I think that was the record this year.
The most in the NHL. They showed they made the playoffs. They made it past the first round. They did a great job this year. It was a lot of fun to watch them, actually. You know, I kind of paid close attention because they were just a team that was fun to watch.
It was very fun.
What have you found that you've learned about being a professional from this game?
Just attention to details, you know, that's what the notice is. Stopping at the net, moving your feet, making tape-to-tape passes all the time, and just working as hard as you can at all times. No slacking, no being lazy.
That's definitely one of the things the Flames have been preaching. You know, they're pretty much saying if you're lazy, if you're not giving 100%, we don't want you here. So, yeah, I'm glad they're instilling that in all the rookies coming in.
Yeah.
If you're, as you're going back to the WHL, what are some of the lessons you think that you can take from maybe something the coaches have told you or something, you know, new that you've learned this week that's going to help your game next year?
Definitely my defensive side and my angling. I think that's one of my weak spots is definitely my defensive side of the game. And again, the work ethic, it always comes back to that's what they emphasize so much here. And I got to go back there and I got to be a leader in Kelowna now. We have a little bit of a younger team than last year, so I got the lead.
And you'll be one of the leaders on that team for sure.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for your time, and we hope to see you around the Flames organization more. Thanks, Rob.
And we're here at WinSport on the final day of training camp with one of the Flames' longer-term prospects, but one that's probably not as well-known as some of these guys to the Sea of Red, and that's Matt DeBlow.
It's a different outfit for you.
Yeah.
Have you seen you guys in the red and the black?
I know. It's been a long week, but I think it's been a good week. And it's good that I got through it, and good that I think I did well. And
you survived the hike?
Yeah, exactly.
You guys did a three-hour hike in 1 hour, I heard?
Yeah. Yeah, it was a little fast-paced. Legs were burning, I think, the entire time. But after you climb it, I mean, it's something you can check off the list.
Going down's the easy part.
Yeah.
So, you've been around the Flames organization for a while now. You're one of the guys who's playing in, you know, U.S. college. And as we've seen over the past little bit, the Flames have been getting more college players into the system. That has to be fairly exciting for you to know that there's a lot more chances for the young guys here now.
Yeah, I think it's great for, leaves the pressure off me year by year. I mean, I know going into my senior year, I'm going to have a little bit more pressure. Mm-hmm. But to develop, I think it's not so you have to do it right now.
Yeah.
And you could take, like, I had a bad sophomore year, so it took a little bit longer for me. But I'm glad that I had the 4 years that I had with school and enabled, like, for me to develop.
You've been here through a few regime changes in the Flames office. You've seen, you know, a few guys come and go. What do you find is the difference now with the sort of Treliving and Hartley era of the Flames?
You know, I think it's just it's set in stone. I mean, there's no ifs, ands, or buts. Like, you have to work hard. The little things make the difference. I mean, that's just like with any game. One turnover can cost the game. So I think that's great. I love it. Going hard to the net every time. You have to stop. I mean, just the little things that you should do as a player every single time. I mean, these guys harp on all the time.
What do you believe that you have to do to improve your game moving forward?
I think I have to get a little bit bigger physically. I think as a senior, I definitely have to take more of a leadership role and hopefully advance my team more into the playoffs and more of a top 10 type team in the country.
For Flames fans that haven't seen a lot of you, how would you describe your game? What player might you compare yourself to?
I mean, I like to think that I want to play like Dak too, but you know, I would be a role guy, you know, win the draws, good on the penalty kill, give energy to the guys, and I'm always having fun out there. So,
based on what you've learned at this camp now going forward, what do you think the biggest thing you're going to have to work on before the season is?
I think just bearing down a little bit more and going hard in the off season, working out, and getting stronger.
All right, well, thanks for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
So this is Dan and Matt here on the final day of camp with John Gillies. We'll start by congratulating you and Providence College on your big win in the national championship.
Thank you very much.
You've played with a couple other Flames prospects. You played with Jankowski and Gilmore for a while. And you guys are all pretty much, you know, growing through the system together. You've all come in about the same time. Are you seeing growth not only in your game but in some of your teammates as well?
Oh, for sure. I mean, you look at especially Mark Jankowski from where he was when he was drafted at 160 pounds.
Yeah.
Now he's pushing 200 pounds. He's really put the work in on and off the ice. And it's been fun to watch his growth. He was a huge, huge player, maybe our best forward this year. So he's a big part of our team and a big part of our win. So. John Gilmore, I mean, you can't say enough good things about his skating or about his hockey sense. It's really fun to play behind him, and we were talking about it at the end of the season. We're going to miss each other back there, but hopefully we can be together again soon.
After you signed, you got to practice with the Flames as they went into the playoffs. What was that experience like for you?
It was pretty cool. I mean, obviously those guys can shoot the puck, and they know exactly where they're putting it every time, so it's more you learn to trust your positioning. College might be able to get away with relying on my reactions and stuff like that. So definitely picked up a lot of things and worked with Jordan Sigla a lot, just one-on-one. So really tried to refine the details of the games and really key in what makes me successful. And it was a really fun time on and off the ice. You guys are unbelievable. It's unbelievable to see the run they put together.
Coming into your first full pro season this year, turning pro, what do you think is the biggest thing you're going to have to work on in your game before the season starts?
I think it's just being prepared for a little longer haul. I mean, college, you come in, you play two games on the weekend, and then you just, what's it called?
Off-ice training?
Well, yeah, then you get practice, so it means kind of regroup yourself. I mean, and now in pro, you have a game every day, something like that. So
plus all the travel in there.
Yeah, and so it's going to be adjustment for sure, but I mean, I think the last 3 years have prepared me well for it, definitely with the balance of knowing how to balance school and practice and things like that. So preparation is key, and that's going to be the way I say.
How many more classes do you have to take?
I have a little less than a year left. I might take some throughout the season this year. I was going to take some this summer, but I really want to focus on training and being in the best shape possible for camp, so kind of eliminate this distraction as much as possible. But like I said, yeah, probably less than a year.
Yeah. What are you majoring in?
Business management.
That'll be a good major to have going into this field.
Yeah, it's... I like the management side of things. My dad, my grandpa owns a public company, my dad runs it, so I get to see it that way and see different areas of it. So it's been fun.
Cool. So you were mentioning you working with Jordan Sigla before, and you know some of the Flames, you know, their goaltending coaching, and it seems like one of the things the Flames are doing this year is they're really getting all the goalies at all levels to kind of be in sync. You know, Jordan's working with the AHL guys, some of the ECHL guys. Do you think that's going to help with the transition when it is time to make the jump to the NHL, that all the goalies kind of know what's expected?
Yeah, but I worked with Siggy and Scotty. Just Siggy for the first week and a half, 2 weeks, while the AHL season was still going on. And then when Scotty got there, I took over and started working with him. So I got to work with both guys. They see eye to eye and everything. They're both great coaches, great people. And it's a pleasure to work with both of them. What they say, you listen, because they know exactly what they're talking about, and it shows on the news.
What are you most looking forward to this season?
Just having fun with it, just being a pro for the first time. I mean, it's what you dream about when you're 9, 10 years old. I mean, I've always wanted to be a hockey player. My whole family's been hockey players, so be able to get to this level, I'm really blessed to be here, and I think I make the most of it.
Well, thanks, Jonah. We're looking forward to seeing you in Calgary soon. We're here on the last day of rookie camp with Josh Pitt, one of the trio players. Josh, first off, welcome to Calgary.
Thank you.
How was your hike yesterday?
It was a little rough. I got a nice 2-inch blister on my right foot to show for it.
So, ouch.
Yeah.
I heard you guys did a 3-hour hike in 1 hour.
Yeah, I think it was about a clock then, about an hour.
Wow. And Stampede, was this your first time at Stampede this year?
Yep. Yeah, first time in Western Canada.
And wow.
Yeah.
And how'd you like the Stampede?
It was fun. Yeah, we didn't get to... We didn't stay for too long, but when we were there, it was a lot of fun.
Now you know what to look forward to if you come to Calgary to play.
Very true.
So as one of the guys here who doesn't have a Flames contract right now, I have to imagine that one of the reasons you decided to try out with the Flames is because of the opportunities that they've been giving to young players over the past couple of years and seeing some of that development through the system. That has to be encouraging for you.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, when you look at, like, my teammate Kenny just came here and he got in a bunch of games in Adirondack and he played well, and it's probably going to work out good for him. So, I mean, yeah, that's one thing you look for when looking at teams is players, giving young players a chance. And
the Flames have really been doing their homework and bringing in a lot more college guys lately, a lot more guys from, you know, U.S. schools and that sort of thing, which we haven't seen in the last couple of years. Is this team starting to get a reputation as a good team for college players to be looking at?
I mean, yeah, I think so. Like I said again with Kenny, like, he came in and got a chance, and I think anywhere you can do that, it's always going to be a big boost for the team.
So for Flames fans that don't know your game, can you describe who you are as a hockey player?
I try to be, I mean, a big center, kind of pretty tough down the middle, hard to play against, hitting the body, chipping in some offense here and there.
A Brian Burke-style truculent centerman.
Yeah, well, if I can do that, then at least one person's happy.
Exactly. So, but from what you've learned this week, working with the Flames staff and the rookies here, what do you think the biggest thing you're going to have to improve on before you hit the ice for the regular season is?
Just probably bringing consistency. Just doing the same things night in, night out, and never taking a game off, and trying to be the best player I can be every night, and hopefully turn it into a good year.
And you're not eligible to be back at the Flames main camp if they wanted you to because of your school commitments, correct?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I'd have to sign.
So they'd have to sign you.
Yeah.
So really, this will be the probably the only time you'll be on the ice with the Flames. But do you think this opportunity this week has helped your game, helped you improve, and see what it's going to take to be at the pro level?
Absolutely. There's a bunch of. By a handful of guys that have already been in the A for a while and have played pro and played in the show. So just playing against them and seeing what that level of compete is like, I think it's going to be great to bring back to my school.
What do you think you've learned the most from this camp?
Obviously, the hard work is the biggest thing that they preach here. So the first day we did video, it's kind of like back-checking and stick on puck and keep pucks out of the middle. I thought that was really helpful. To me, I try to use it in the rest of the practices in the scrimmage.
We've been really impressed by what we've seen from you this week, and we're hoping to see you back in Calgary soon.
All right, thanks a lot.
So this is Dan and Matt, and we're here after the final day of the training camp with Jacob Nakladal. First off, welcome to Calgary.
Is this
your first NHL camp?
Yeah.
And how are you finding the pace here compared to what you're used to over in Europe?
For me, it's really fun to be here because it's absolutely different hockey, different war than in Europe. and for me it's the big chance to get in NHL. So
you're still adjusting to the different rink size?
Yeah, it's different, but I think it's just maybe about 1 week to like acclimate it, and I think it's for me it's not a problem because I like to play aggressive play and hard play, so I think it's in this I think it's better than in big ring.
For Flames fans who aren't as familiar with your game, how would you describe yourself as a player?
I think I told it maybe twice in this week. I think I'm somewhere in the middle, not just offense, but just defense, and I like to support offense, and like I said, I like aggressive play, so I think I can play both sides.
And that's good, because the Calgary coaches are encouraging you guys to jump into the rush and that sort of thing, be more offensive. So
yeah, I think in this time, in this hockey today, it's important to play not just to defense, but in Europe, it's a really good example is Sweden or Finland, because they want to play all the five guys up and down. So I think this is very good.
How did you enjoy the hike yesterday?
it was okay. I think there was a nice view.
Yeah.
But before, I think we went it or walk it 1 hour, yeah. Something around 1 hour. So it was not so easy, but it was okay. It was nice. Yes. Very nice.
So you're one of the older guys here at camp. Obviously, you have a couple years on everybody else that's here. How are you finding adjusting to playing with the younger guys? Are you doing anything different because you're playing with, you know, 17, 18-year-olds?
Yeah. I think it's a big difference. But all the guys here are pretty good players. But I think it's a little bit different to play in like men's hockey and junior hockey. The big difference is like in head that men's hockey is more smarter, and it's different for me, but it was okay, and now I feel like a young man again.
That's good. We even had Yari Hudler saying that earlier this year, because he was playing with some of our young guys. Yeah, so he feels like a kid again. So
yeah, but he's a great player, and I think he's a leader, so that's different. But of course, I think it's important thing too, and he did a really good job.
And you're joining the Flames at a great time, because this is an organization that's giving a lot of chances right now. There's a lot of roster spots that are open. So was that one of the reasons you decided to sign with the Flames? You thought there was a great chance to make the NHL here?
Yeah, of course. For me, it was the most important thing, because I'm 27 years old. I played in KHL, and I had a good deal there, so it was like a not easy question for me. But of course, make NHL, it's my dream, and it's absolutely, I think, the best what you can do in hockey. So the Calgary, I hope they could be they could give me the biggest chance, I think, and I hope that I'm gonna do it.
Well, thanks for your time, and we hope to see you in Calgary come September.
And before we wrap up our training camp review, we have a special interview with Assistant General Manager Craig Conroy, who sums up his thoughts of what we saw this week at camp.
So we're here at the end of day two of the rookie camp here in Calgary, and we're with Assistant General Manager Craig Conroy. Craig, one of the things we've heard as we've been talking to the prospects here at camp is everyone's telling us they have to get stronger. Yeah. Is this a mandate coming down from the office? Is this Burke's truculence, you know, going through the organization? Or is this just that, you know, these guys are realizing on their own that they need to get bigger to play in the NHL?
Well, I think it's just really more than anything, it's the testing. So when you look at the standard testing we do in the NHL for NHL players, they can look to see where they are. And everyone just can look and say, oh, you know what, if I want to be the average of an NHL player, I need to get stronger is one of the big things. I think overall, anaerobic capacity, how long they can go is a little bit, but a lot of the things the guys do well. I mean, their core strengths are good, and you know, their peak power is really good, for surprisingly for a lot of guys. So for a sprint, they're great. Mm-hmm. They just need to work on the overall explosion in their and their strength in the lower body. I mean, so once they get that going, it's just going to get them up to speed where NHL players have been, you know, because Ryan, our strength coach, was in LA. Yeah. And they had some bigger guys, so he kind of runs off there where their strength was in LA, winning Stanley Cups. It's a pretty good caliber. So that's kind of where it is. But I think Berkey likes bigger, stronger. But like we said, I think the one guy that really did well from last year to this year was Hickey. Brandon came in. He was pretty light last year, put on 12, 13 pounds. And his body fat was the same. And that's what you want. You know, you don't want a guy to put on 13 pounds and 4-5% body fat. You want to be lean, strong, and put on that right weight. I mean, because when we talk about stronger, that's the real focus for us, is we want you to be lean, muscle, fast, explosive, powerful.
For sure. Outside of the on-ice, which, you know, we're all seeing here, what else are these guys doing while they're at this camp this week?
So up every day we broke into really small groups this year, so Ryan could be hands-on up in the gym, and they're groups of 10. So they'll go through all kinds of different training things, how we do it. How are you going to get better? How are you going to get stronger? You know, show them the drills and actually be able to work with them one-on-one. If he sees a correction, he can make it right away. And then they do, you know, we have nutrition. They were up cooking the other day. Oh, wow. They made six or eight meals. I'm not sure how many, but actually they did a good job. I walked in there and I'm like, this stuff smells good.
Did you get to try it?
Yeah, the food was actually good. Made some shakes and they did a nice job. I mean, because I don't love the kale shakes, but whatever they put in this one, it actually, I mean, it's not great, but I could drink it down. Well, so, you know, they did a good job. And then we have a few things with, we have security meeting tonight with our security people here in Calgary, just to say, hey, these are some of the problems that have happened in the NHL. This is what you want to avoid. We also have a Twitter and what the media kind of a little session to say, guys, you know, you're here in Calgary. Like, people are going to know who you are. Like, you got to be careful what you tweet out, what you take a picture of, what you say, you know. So a little bit of media.
Especially when they were all at the Stampede Grounds last night.
Yeah, so a little media training never goes, you know, we do that. So we try to give them a little bit of everything and just kind of bring them in. In a small scale, what would happen if you were on the big NHL club?
This past week with the NHL entry draft, getting Dougie Hamilton plus Anderson and Schillington. Now that the defense seems to have been worked on, what do you think is the biggest need in the organization?
If I had to say, I mean, I think we're still looking for maybe natural right winger. We have right wingers, but you'd always like to say one right-handed shot would be nice. Yeah. You know, we have Jones, and that's about it. Everybody else on our right side is mostly left shots. So, but you have a guy like Austin Carroll coming in a right shot. I mean, you do have younger guys, Hunter Smith, but you know, probably if one area would be bringing in all these guys, we want to strengthen up the right side and maybe get a right shot.
It's really exciting to see, you know, the I guess importance the organization has put on youth this past year. And talking to these guys, you can tell that they're really excited about the, you know, the prospect of moving up. Have you guys been telling them that there are jobs available now as we see the makeup of how the Flames have been, you know, working over the last year?
For sure. I mean, the one thing we say, hey, there was four guys in the room last year here at this development camp that were playing in the NHL. So, you know, is there going to be four more? We don't know. That's up to you guys. Mm-hmm. You know, in the end, you determine. You know, we always said you have to come, and Bob's thing is you steal a jersey. You know, no one's going to give you a jersey. Yeah. You need to steal one, and those guys want to keep theirs. So it's a battle. But you got to give them, you know, whether it's your training, your commitment to on ice, everything you do, getting ready for this camp is about making the team. You know, Sammy was able to play in the team last year. He's still got to earn it this year. Yep. I mean, there's no givens. I mean, obviously, he played great, but he's got to come and be ready to compete in camp. So that's kind of thing. And, you know, the Josh Juris is a perfect one. He came to the camp as a college free agent. We signed him. 2 years later, he's in the NHL.
Exactly.
I mean, that's what it's all about. Kids want opportunity, and we're saying, hey, we're a team that likes young players
and gives opportunities.
So yeah, it's,
and we've been talking to some of the college guys. They were mentioning Juris.
Yeah, you know, I mention Juris every time.
Yeah.
But it's good, you know. And I think even with Kenny Morrison coming on this year, you know, we have different guys from college. Hey, these are important guys. Just because you weren't drafted doesn't mean
Look at our captain. Start.
Yeah,
our captain wasn't drafted by this organization.
Not in junior either.
Yeah,
you know, never drafted in junior, and look where he's gone. I mean, it's all about hard work. Gio put it in, and you know that he is the one guy I use when I talk to junior players that, you know, just because you're drafted or not drafted. You gotta put the work in, and you keep working. It's a marathon to get to this level.
What are you most looking forward to this upcoming season?
You know, I just think I think a little bit of the anticipation of with Dougie Hamilton and Frolik, see how this is all gonna mesh, and get off to a good start. I mean, I think there's the expectations were maybe a little lower last year, and then we just got off and we're going good, but you know every team's going to be gunning for us. All these teams in the West say, who are we going to knock out? We got to knock Calgary out. LA is going to be chomping to get back in, Dallas. So, I mean, I want to see us get off to a good start, and you know, that's the thing. You want to have a good training camp and then just build on it from there.
Thanks a lot, Greg.
Fireside Chat is edited by Mike Crosby and Brett Bauer. This show is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license information, visit firesidechat.ca.